We are podcasting from the Diocese of Raleigh Studios. Thank you for joining us on another edition of A Catholic Life. I'm your host, Billy Atwell. Before we get started, I want to remind everybody about some of the ministries of charity, evangelization, and worship that are only made possible because of the generosity from the faithful to the Bishop's Annual Appeal. To give you just a sense of the impact that the Bishop's Annual Appeal has each year, Catholic Charities has helped roughly 64,000 people last year alone, and they are the primary beneficiary of the Bishop's Annual Appeal. The BAA also helps some of our poorer parishes. It protects the unborn and the vulnerable, and it helps the Catholic Church in Eastern North Carolina in many other ways. Another example is it pays for this our seminarians to become priests. It pays for their formation. We just had transitional diaconate ordination of Deacon McGee and Deacon Urego, who are, God willing, going to be ordained Catholic priests next year. So please consider the Bishop's Annual Appeal this year. And if you've been generous in the past, we are so very grateful for your contribution, and we would pray that you would do so again this year as well. We even consider increasing the amount with which you help these vital ministries. Today I have with me a friend of the diocese, Luke Farley, who is heading up an effort to bring a St. Thomas More Society of the Triangle to the Triangle, and he's a local attorney. Luke, thank you so much for joining me.
Billy, it's my pleasure. I am excited for a chance to talk about the life of St. Thomas More.
Yeah, you've got a personal passion in addition to obviously a professional interest in St. Thomas More, the patron saint of statesmen and politicians and attorneys, but you've got a kind of a personal devotion to him as well.
Yeah, I certainly do. My interest in him started when I was applying for law school, and that is a tough process. And at the time, I was living in Chapel Hill. And as you probably know, there's a church there named in his honor. So I would stop in and pray in front of his statue, which is a beautiful statue. They've now got it sort of in the vestibule area. It had been in the sanctuary. And I would pray and ask for his help to help me get into law school, and because he was the patron saint of lawyers. And it sort of started there. And interest in him has stayed with me ever since because I think he is a great model for lawyers.
Why is that? What is it? I mean, obviously he was a lawyer, and you know, we'll get into more of his background and his life and his trial and execution and so on. But what particularly do you think about his life is so compelling for people in your profession?
His integrity, above all. He went to his death upholding principles that he firmly believed in. He had a well-formed Catholic conscience, and he stood by that. And integrity is something we always need in the legal profession.
Yeah, it's almost the bad joke right anymore about attorneys. You know, they kind of have this bad reputation.
Sure.
But, you know, just from the diocese, we know so many Catholics who are attorneys that are such good and, you know, upholding citizens, and they've got such integrity, men like yourself, quite frankly. And we'll get into a little bit more later, but this society that you're putting together is intended to bring people like that to the same place in community. Talk a little bit about what that's intended to do.
The idea is that Catholic lawyers should have a forum to come together and celebrate the fact that they are Catholic and that they're part of the legal profession. And that's the idea, is that the St. Thomas More Society will allow Catholic lawyers to come together and learn from each other, pray together, socialize together, and just be sort of a subset of the Catholic community.
St. Thomas More, in his early life, he was raised by a father who was an attorney. Mm-hmm. Do you have attorneys in your background, or what made you interested in the profession itself?
No. As far as I know, I'm the first in my family, but I have always thought that the law is an opportunity to help people and to do something good. I practice primarily civil law, and I have enjoyed being able to help people resolve disputes in a peaceful way. You know, if there's criminal law, that helps people. It keeps society safe. So it's an opportunity to help people, and it's also an opportunity to just do interesting work. The legal profession is almost always interesting.
Yeah. So talk a little bit about, you know a lot about St. Thomas More. Talk about his early life, kind of his more formative years. What were those like?
Well, one of the most interesting things I think that's worth pointing out is that he was not a member of the nobility. So he was not part of the aristocracy. He was not the nobility. He did not have royal blood. And that's important in this period in time when so much of what you could do in life was governed by what class you were born into. I think today we would say he was probably, we would probably call it middle class or upper middle class. Like you said, his father had been a judge. But in his early life, he was sent to go learn from the Archbishop of Canterbury, who was also the Lord Chancellor of England. So when he's 12 years old, he gets sent to learn about public service from the Archbishop. He spends a couple of years there, and then he goes off to college. He spends 2 years at Oxford, but at that time, he didn't have to go to college to be a lawyer. His father wanted him to be a lawyer, so he moves to London. And for me, that's where the story begins to get really interesting. He goes to – the method of teaching the law at that point was you would basically an apprenticeship system. But he chose to live during his apprenticeship when he gets started in the law next to some Carthusian monks in a place called the London Charter House.
Yeah, he's well known for being a saint who is married. Many saints are religious sisters or they're priests or they're not all by any means, but a lot are. And he's almost one of the most well-known laymen who is married. But it seems like he almost became a monk because he was so devoted to that spirituality.
Yeah, so he spent 4 years living near the Carthusian monks and praying with them, learning from them. And just in my reading of his life, I think that ends up being one of the most important factors in his spirituality, that he becomes his spirituality seems to get very deep from the time he spent with the monks, and he does discern whether he does try to discern a vocation to the priesthood or to the lay and married life, and ultimately he chooses, with God's help, the lay life.
What do you think made him interested in that? Like, why did he write anything about why his call drove him that direction?
Yeah, interestingly enough, he didn't think he was good enough to be a priest.
That's almost ironic knowing the end of the story.
Sure, yeah, exactly, right? I mean, his courage and fortitude by the end of his life are, I mean, that's what he's best known for. But he was a harsh judge of his own character, and he said, I don't think that I have the fortitude to remain, totally faithful to all that you're required to do as a priest. I just don't know. He just didn't have that confidence in himself. So he ended up discerning lay and married life.
So in 1505, I think it was, he married Jane Colt, his first wife. They had four children together. Talk about that time period and if there's things that are notable about his children.
So it was a very prayerful home. There are recorded accounts that as he was raising his children, his family and he would pray together and with the people who worked in their home. So it was a prayerful home. They would end the day in prayer. And uniquely at that time, he was a big proponent of educating women. So his daughters ultimately were usually better educated than most of the men of that era. And one of his daughters, Meg, I think it was, turned out to be really adept at translating. And so she became well known actually for translating things from Latin into English or Greek into English. So it was unique among that at that time.
Now, Meg, that's her full name was Margaret, is that right?
Yes. Yeah.
Isn't she the one that was the most kind of noted in the sense that she had a more active role in his life, especially in his professional life? I remember when I was at Cardinal Gibbons, we did a project on St. Thomas More, and I think she even, like, he would wear a hair shirt. That was one of the things that, that he did, one of kind of his penances. And it would get gross, it was unhygienic at point, and she would actually take it when there would be a period where I have it off and clean it. And do this thing. And she was very active in that way. And later on, she, visited him in the Tower of London and so on. What's kind of her story? Is there much background on what happened with her with regard to his life?
I think that she's understood to be probably his favorite child. And she was particularly close to him.
Right.
You're right. I'm glad you mentioned that he wore a hair shirt, because that to me is one of the striking details of his life. If any of your listeners aren't familiar with it, it's basically like wearing a burlap sack against your skin. So you wear it under your clothes. And
yeah, he didn't make like a public scene.
Right, exactly. Right. So it was a secret. Not a lot of people knew that he wore it. His daughter Meg was one of them. And it was really I think it was indicative of the closeness that they had that she knew that he chose to, you know, live out this penance.
He also, I think what's interesting about the fact that he wore the hair shirt and so on is that it's almost a juxtaposition to his lot in life at that point, right? He's in a very high position. He's a well-known scholar. He's got a significant role in government. But yet there's this other side that is very penitent and recognizes his sin and his weakness and constantly trying to do better and be holy. Very opposite of what we would think of in terms of someone in his position, where there's nothing but comforts in their life.
Yeah, I think that's a wonderful point. That he had comfort in his life. I mean, he ended up making a decent amount of money, at least until he resigned. But he never let that get in the way of developing his relationship with God. So he wore a hair shirt. He was known to set aside all Fridays of the year for his own spiritual exercises, set them aside as days of prayer. And it's a good model for anybody who achieves some worldly success that no matter how successful you are, whether you're the Lord Chancellor of England or what have you, there's got to be room for God in your life.
Yeah, absolutely. Now his first wife passed away. Mm-hmm. He then remarried. Tell us a little bit about his second wife.
Sure. So his second wife there, it was not it was a loving marriage, but it was a marriage that he entered into in order to help take care of his family.
Right.
Because when his wife died, he was widowed and he had several children at that point. So it's not the kind of marriage people think of today, but by all accounts, it was very happy. And
now she was a widower or a widow as well.
Yes, that's right.
And she brought a child, I think, to the relationship also.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. So talk a little bit about, so he had this fast, you know, this climb, you know, through government where he had, you know, various roles, kind of capping it off with the Lord Chancellor. Talk about what that role is, because I think it's important to understand the height of his success because it shows you the depths of the fall and all that he gave up to live according to the principles he believed, mm-hmm. that the church believes. Talk a bit briefly about that climb, but also what a Lord Chancellor is in England.
Yeah, so he spends 4 years learning the law, living with the Carthusian monks, not in their chapter house, but learning from them. And once he finishes his training, his career is like a rocket ship. It's one accolade after another, one government post after another, until about the year 1519, he catches the attention of Cardinal Wolsey, who is the Lord Chancellor at that point, and the king. Interestingly, so he's practicing law. He wins a case where he's representing someone against the crown, against the government. That finally gets the attention of the king and Wolsey, and they say, we need this guy in our service. So from 1519 or so on, he is in the service of the king, one office after another, and his career culminates in being appointed Lord Chancellor of England. And
that happened 10 years later?
Yeah,
right?
So
1529, I think.
Yeah, 1529, exactly. So he's in the service of the king for about 10 years until he's appointed Lord Chancellor, and we don't have an equivalent office in the American system of government, but it's probably something akin to being Chief Justice of the U.S. Supreme Court, maybe with a little bit of Attorney General mixed in.
Wow.
So very, very high position in government, probably the second most powerful man in England after the king, maybe the third, kind of debatable, but he is right at the top.
How long was he in that post?
Unfortunately, he's only in there about 3 years before he has to the controversy over Henry's marriage and seeking a divorce from Catherine of Aragon. And that's actually brewing when he takes the position. When he takes the position or is given the position in 1529, it's vacated because Cardinal Wolsey, who was the Lord Chancellor, had died, and there was already the dispute brewing. So he takes the job with that in mind, and he's in there for about 3 years before things get so bad that he resigns.
Talk about that process of, you know, so he starts kind of already knowing there's some issues here. He might have even had some reservation, for all I know, about taking the job in the first place because of that. What did those 3 years look like? Talk
sure.
about the progress of that.
Well, you do bring up an interesting point about him knowing what he was getting into, because I think he certainly did. There's this story told that he was talking with his son-in-law, and his son-in-law says, "Aren't you so proud now that you've won the king's favor and you've reached this high position? How does it feel to be this close associate of the king?" And Thomas More tells him, he says basically, "I'm pretty sure that if my head would win him a castle in France, it should not fail to go," meaning he'll throw me under the bus if it gets him anywhere. And it turns out that it does. So he knew what he was getting into. I think he knew that Henry was a dangerous, impetuous character to be dealing with. But he answered the call from his king to come into this position. But anyway, so he takes the job, and the divorce controversy is brewing.
So for people that aren't familiar with the situation, talk about what that controversy is.
So Henry VIII had been married to his queen, Catherine of Aragon, by that point for about 20 years. And that marriage failed to produce a male heir. So Henry didn't have a son. He wanted a son. And so he was looking for a reason to not be married to Catherine of Aragon and marry a woman he had met at court, Anne Boleyn. He had requested an annulment from the church. He didn't get it. It went all the way up to the Holy Father. I think it was Pope Clement VIII, maybe. And it was denied. And the denial of that annulment is what precipitated the break with the church in Rome. And it's that controversy that St. Thomas More became embroiled in, and that ultimately cost him his life.
Now, Anne Boleyn, was her family politically savvy? Was this a positioning, or did they happen to meet and be attracted to each other, or was this really a jockeying for a position on the behalf of the family?
My understanding is that the Boleyns were jockeying for position, as you say. They were present at court, and that's where she first caught Henry's eye, and he thought she would make a suitable replacement to Catherine of Aragon, which I think I mentioned this earlier. It's always striking to me when you hear this story, people seem to forget that he had been married to Catherine of Aragon for 20 years,
right,
and he wanted to put her aside after 20 years of being together for Anne Boleyn. But I take it to be that the family was angling for a position. I mean, the Boleyns.
Now, you said that they met at court. What does court mean?
Court means it's sort of the collection of people around the king, is the way I would describe it.
Like a cabinet almost? Or
sort of, yeah, but it's not all government. Some of it's social,
okay.
Social, governmental, just sort of the people who are with the king on a regular basis.
Okay. So the situation was brewing. He casts aside, or he's kind of casting aside his wife, Catherine.
Trying to, at least, right?
He's trying to. At what point does he declare that there's a divorce? Is that how it works, that he declares there's a divorce? Obviously, the Pope isn't recognizing this.
Right.
Talk a bit about that process. I think it's easier in today's day and age to think about divorce and someone leaving a spouse and having a girlfriend, like in this case, because we hear it more commonly. You know, infidelity is more common now than it may have been back then. So for the King of England to disregard a wife with a political family and all the power that comes with that, and essentially declare himself as taking on a new wife before it's any of that's actually final, it's incredibly scandalous, especially given the time period.
Yeah.
Talk about kind of that whole situation, but then when does he start taking very aggressive inroads to make this a declaration contrary to what the Vatican is
saying? So it's going on, like I said, when St. Thomas More takes the position. Cardinal Wolsey, who had been the chancellor, was tasked with securing the annulment for Henry VIII,
okay,
and he can't do it. The Pope is not going to budge. And so he loses favor with the king. He probably, good for him, he dies of natural causes as opposed to having a tangle with the king anymore. The position becomes vacant. In 1529, St. Thomas More takes it. And within about a year, Henry has issued a proclamation to the clergy of the country that the clergy have to recognize him as the head of the church in England. And it only gets worse from there.
Did he have any power over the clergy before this point?
He had temporal power.
Okay.
But he was not a religious leader in the sense you would think of. He was the temporal ruler, and that's what the controversy ultimately becomes.
So what his declaration there that the clergy will recognize us,
right.
Is that procedurally strange?
I would say it was. And it's the first step. So when that happens, Thomas More offers to resign. He's not clergy. So initially that proclamation has nothing to do with him.
You might have seen the writing on the wall.
Right. So he offers to resign, and that offer is rejected. So he stays in office for a while longer. As the controversy deepens, both Parliament and the king get more aggressive, and they start passing a bunch of several statutes that really are what bring St. Thomas's downfall. There's two of them. We can talk about them a bit, the Act of Succession, the Act of Supremacy. And you can kind of lump them all together. In short, they want all people who are asked to take an oath that promises that King Henry is the head of the church in England as well as the ruler of the government, the temporal ruler.
At what point is Thomas or St. Thomas More brought in head to head with it and have to make some action saying, okay, I tried, but I can't move forward? Because he does try to almost create not an accommodation, because it makes it sound like he's negotiating his faith or his principles.
No, he's being a lawyer is what it is. He's being a lawyer. And there
is he lawyering here?
He's lawyering, but in good conscience and in good faith.
Right.
So I think the issue really starts to come to a head in 1534.
Okay.
He's dead by the next year, unfortunately. But in 1534, about 3 or 4 years as Lord Chancellor, he's asked to take this oath. And the oath is going to say a couple of things. You have to promise or swear that the marriage between Henry and Anne Boleyn is a valid marriage. You also have to swear that any children they have are properly in the line of succession to the king. So any kids they have are legitimate, if you will, and that they can then succeed to the throne. And that the objections of anybody else in the world, you know, read the Pope, play no part in your decision as to this. And failure to take the oath is treason. So St. Thomas More and St. John Fisher, who was Bishop of Rochester, who was martyred right around the same time, they say, okay, we agree that you as Parliament can pass any law you want that says who is rightfully in line to become the king. That's a government function. You pick who's the king. Fair game. What we can't do is swear that Henry is in any position to judge the validity of his own marriage. So we'll swear half the oath, but not the rest of it. And to me, that's a totally fair parsing of the oath.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a reasonable approach to it. But even being reasonable was not going to save either of their lives, St. Thomas More or St. John Fisher, because once they refuse to swear the oath in its entirety, they're sent to the Tower of London. And St. Thomas More thereafter never leaves the Tower of London again. He spends 15 months there after refusing to swear the oath.
Why did King Henry VIII, why was he so bent on the marriage being valid when they're agreeing to the fact that the succession, which seemed to be his ultimate goal, he wanted to make sure that he had a line of succession, and if he's not going to have that with Catherine of Aragon, he's going to find another way to do that. Why did he insist on the marriage being valid? Because it wasn't necessary to getting the line of succession that he wanted.
You know, that's a really interesting question that I have not thought a lot about. I assume it's for appearances.
Probably pride and other
pride
things too.
and not wanting. At that point, maybe it became a test of wills. And he was going to say, I am the supreme authority and I can pass judgment on the validity of my own marriage.
Wow. That's another interesting point that you and I have discussed before is, in today's world, in the United States today, it's more we kind of separate the sense of a sacramental marriage from a civil marriage. We get a marriage certificate from the government. We don't see that as binding on the sacramental marriage in terms of the church. But there wasn't this sense of one marriage versus another. We've seen that it almost become more of a dichotomy now with so-called same-sex marriage and that causing controversy civilly. It doesn't bind sacramental marriage. The church is continuing to do what it does there. But there wasn't that sense of split at this point in time in England. So talk a bit about kind of what that meant for people that he was going to declare on his own marriage. He's basically declaring for the church.
Sure. Yeah, you're exactly right. There was no split between – there was no civil marriage and sacramental marriage. It was all the same thing. And so he did require the ministry of the church if he was going to get an annulment. It did require the ministry of the church at that time to declare that there had been no valid marriage from the beginning. And so for him to take that authority for himself was a radical change. But the church, I think, and government have always been in tension. I have no doubt they'll continue to remain in tension. And so what you were seeing play out there is sort of foreshadowing where we are today.
So he's in the Tower of London. He's imprisoned for not being willing to accept the marriage as being valid. He's willing to accept these other conditions of line of succession and so on. He's there for 15 months. His daughter, Margaret, which is why I brought her up earlier, she visits him at least a few times, I understand.
Oh, yeah.
What do we know about that exchange?
The most incredible story that I have come across about Meg, Margaret, is that she visited him probably – the last time they saw each other was maybe about 2 months before he was executed. And he spent those final 2 months kind of in isolation without his family. But the last time they see each other, they are together in his cell in the Tower of London. And they can see out the window three Carthusian monks and a religious sister – I'm not sure what order – are executed, and they watch it from their window for refusing to take the oath. And so, you know, Meg has got to be telling him, this is what's coming for you. Just swear the oath and get out of here. Interestingly, he is the only lay person in all of England executed for refusing to swear the oath. There were religious who refused to swear the oath and were executed, like St. John Fisher. But he's the only lay person who stood firm against the king's authority.
And that's a profound witness. Obviously, we expect priests and religious sisters, but were there a lot of lay Catholics that did swear the oath? I mean, I don't know how many people were asked to swear the oath, but was it striking how many didn't do what St. Thomas More did?
To me, it is. I don't know exactly the mechanics of how the oath worked. I think it worked that you had to swear it if asked.
Right.
But it wasn't everybody come down and today's the day in front of the king you swear the oath. It was if asked. And so a lot of prominent citizens would be asked, and so were members of the clergy. But I think it is striking that he's the only lay person who didn't go along with the program, if you will.
Now, we've heard, you know, either through media, you know, TV or movies, whatever, about the trial, but kind of take us on a Cliff Notes version of that and kind of what is the maybe a key moment that should be almost emblematic of the whole process.
Sure. So he's in the Tower of London for 15 months because he hasn't actually committed any crimes. They don't have anything they can get him on at that point because he remains silent. Part of these laws is that you cannot speak out against the king's authority as head of the church. So Thomas More thinks, and he applies legal principles to say, I can remain silent and I haven't violated the law. I don't have to come out and say the king's in charge. As long as I say nothing, that's fine. So at that point, they have nothing to get him on.
Now, the silence implied consent, correct?
Right, exactly. Under the law at that time, common law in England, silence implied consent. So he was fine to say, if I say nothing, you can assume I support it, not that I oppose it. So he remains silent. They don't have anything to get him on. And then one of his associates basically perjures himself and says, we had a conversation in private, and St. Thomas More told me what he really thinks of the oath and says the king has no authority. He didn't do that. He had always remained silent, but he's put on trial in Westminster Hall, which is where Parliament meets today, Big Ben, the Houses of Parliament. You can go there. You can see the spot where his trial took place. And he remained silent until the very end. Until the very end, when once he's been condemned, he knows the fix is in on him. And he gives this powerful, powerful speech in defense of the church, in defense of the primacy of the See of Peter. But he also forgives the people who have wrongly condemned him. And it's one of the greatest Christian acts that I know of that he did in his life. He tells them, he says, you know, St. Paul was present when St. Stephen was stoned to death, but they're both saints now and they're friends in heaven, and I hope the same happens for you and I, that we'll meet together as friends in heaven.
Wow. Now, that's powerful. Wow, I didn't realize he said that. I've never heard that part of it. Wow, that's powerful because he knows the punishment for the crime. He knows what would happen. And what was that?
Well, that's another interesting point that you bring up. The punishment for treason is to be hung, drawn, and quartered, which is tied to the back of a horse, dragged to the place of execution, hung till you're almost dead, and then your body is unfortunately
dismembered
and mutilated. I'm not sure who's listening, so I don't want to be too graphic if kids are listening on their way to school.
You did a great job, don't worry.
That's what he thinks coming. He's ultimately beheaded, which is considered a more merciful way to kill someone, but he doesn't know that that's going to happen for him. He's expecting to be hung, drawn, and quartered for his position.
Now, Henry VIII actually commuted that sentence to that. Do we know why? Was he trying to appear merciful?
I would guess it was that. Thomas More was a popular figure. And there were times, I think, that Henry in the past had tried to make moves against him. But being such a popular figure, it was tough to do that. I also think that it could be remorse somewhat on Henry's part. He and Thomas More had been friends. And so maybe he still felt some compassion for his friend and tried to grant him a quick death. These days, beheading to us sounds totally barbaric, but I guess back then it was considered merciful.
Wow. I'm glad the standards have changed.
Right, yeah, absolutely.
So he is martyred. He's later beatified by Pope Leo XIII, along with John Fisher, who you mentioned before, and 52 other English martyrs. I wonder if those Carthusians and that religious sister you mentioned, I wonder if those were part of that group.
You know, they're probably a lot of the martyrs of the English Reformation, their names are probably lost to us, unfortunately. They're known to God, but at least we have the example of a prominent person like St. Thomas More, whose life is well documented.
Looking back, so you've taken us from kind of his early days of, you know, formation as an attorney all the way through his martyrdom, which was so public and so well known, and he had 15 months to prepare himself mentally or fold, really. I mean, he really had either option, and Meg even kind of asked him to consider that. You know, look what's going to happen, and I know in the movie A Man for All Seasons, which I believe you've probably seen many times.
Yep.
I own it. I love that movie. But A Man for All Seasons, you know, you see her mention the fact that our family is going to be destitute.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when he resigned his post, or was taken, what was the order? Was he removed from the post and then lost all of his financial?
It happens at the same time. So he resigns, and his suffering begins before he gets to the Tower of London. As soon as he resigns, he basically loses all of his income and becomes shunned in society.
And even if he was able to keep some assets, he can't afford to maintain them.
Right.
You know, his household, he had to, you know, he didn't have servants anymore.
Sure.
And those kinds of things all go away.
Sure. So he immediately feels the effects of his stand on behalf of the truth and of the church. His family has to sell some of their property. He has to dismiss his servants. But he tells his kids, you know, I'm sorry this is happening, but if we have to go out and be beggars, we'll be cheerful beggars together as a family. basically, we'll endure this together. We're not alone. We have each other. Mm.
So looking at his life, you took us from the beginning to the end and all the highs and the lows and the drastic lows in between. What do you think his life, his witness says about, or what impact does it have on people today, do you think? Like what can we look at and say, wow, we could use a little St. Thomas More character here?
The thing I think about most in his life is the fact that he is a sign that nobody is too good to suffer on behalf of Christ, his church, and the truth. I look at St. Thomas More and I think, look at this accomplished man who reached the highest levels of public service in England, highly regarded as a lawyer, highly regarded as a scholar, considered a good man, a man of wit, a talented man, a talented writer. He wrote Utopia. Yet he didn't put aside the opportunity to suffer on behalf of the church. He could have said, I guess, listen, I'm an important guy. I got a lot going on. Let somebody else stand up to Henry. I got a lot to lose.
And other people were, like you said, clergy and so on. There's
right.
already these witnesses out there.
Sure, sure. But he said, no, I have to take a stand as well. I'm not too good for this. He had as much to lose, if not more than most people, but he put it on the line on behalf of the church.
And we're also in a culture now where the government seems increasingly comfortable with the idea of forcing faithful Christians to do things that they don't agree with.
Sure.
It's not just a matter of accommodation. It's not a matter of tolerance. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of you're going to do this even though you disagree with it. With the most recent example obviously being kind of a high-profile case with the Little Sisters of the Poor petitioning in front of the Supreme Court that they wouldn't have to pay for contraception and abortifacients in their health insurance.
Mm-hmm.
It seems redundant and silly to say that the Little Sisters of the Poor should not have to pay for those kinds of things. But the government is saying, no, you will do this. And Thomas More was put in a somewhat similar scenario where it's, you are not only going to accommodate this line of succession and, civilly, but you're actually going to agree to the marriage.
Sure.
So much farther of a step. And it seems like we're looking down that same path here in terms of the disagreement from Christians that's being ignored and almost revolted against by the government.
Yeah, definitely. I think there is enduring interest and devotion to St. Thomas More because we see parallels between our own time and his time. I think the martyrs, for instance, who were fed to the lions in the Colosseum, that seems very distant.
Mm-hmm.
But the idea that the government is going to pass a law that violates my conscience and force me to assent to it, that's very real and very present to us right now.
Mm-hmm.
Thank God people aren't being fed to lions right now,
right,
for the most part. But the kind of persecution that St. Thomas More suffered, that's alive and well in our world today.
And you're right. Internationally, it's certainly alive and well, and there's no society that's above it. You're talking about a society that was the most powerful in the world.
Mm-hmm.
King Henry had an enormous amount of power, and the thought that it could never happen again is silly. One, we're seeing it internationally, but any culture is capable of it at some point in time.
Yeah, I mean, marriage is at the forefront of so much of our public discourse right now, in government, but even in the church. We're talking about do people who are divorced and civilly remarried, are they entitled to go to communion? So marriage even is on people's minds a lot these days, and St. Thomas More stands out as a paradigm for upholding traditional understandings of marriage.
Absolutely. So are you the president of the St. Thomas More Society of the Triangle, or what is your role with it?
I am now, yep.
Okay.
I am helping to found it, and I'm serving as the president.
So if there's an attorney that's interested in learning more about it, how should they reach out?
They can contact me via email. My email is lfarley@cgsplc.com. That's my work email, lfarley@cgsplc.com.
Very cool. Well, thank you so much for leading that effort. I mean, especially in a growing diocese like ours, the idea of lay associations of Catholics, mm-hmm. you know, that have some commonality, whether it be professional or social, whatever it might be, is a wonderful thing to see. And we're so grateful that you're leading that effort and bringing these good people together, and for your leadership in that. Thank you so much. And for your time for this interview. I know that you're very busy, but I appreciate you giving us the time.
Well, I think I've probably told you this before. I will talk as much about St. Thomas More as people are willing to listen, so I appreciate it too.
Very well. Thank you very much. And thank you all for listening to A Catholic Life podcast. You can find us under the multimedia section of dioceseofraleigh.org. It's there that you can find other video and podcast offerings like Raleigh to Rome, our weekly 6-minute or less news brief on local and global Catholic news. You can get the latest from the diocese sent directly to your email inbox, just like this podcast. Just go to dioceseofraleigh.org and click on the email newsletter link in the footer. And don't forget, the many programs, ministries, and charities of the diocese are made possible because of your generous contributions to the bishop's annual appeal. And as always, may God continue to bless you and those that you love.